There's many problems that you can see with FDI. Some of them relate to taxation. Taxation is one of the biggest contributions that FDI can have in low-income countries, but we're going to hear more this afternoon. But it's unclear how FDI actually complies with their tax dues. Profit remittances as well, a big problem. Also, in terms of the distribution, sectoral distribution, we see a strong concentration in telecommunications and also extractives. Telecommunications is a sector where you basically earn your income from domestic users, and this can have a very strong balance of payment impact if you then repatriate the profits. But many others, I'm not going to go in detail. But the truth behind the IFC is this one. Basically, the IFC and all MDBs have quarterly reports to their bigger shareholders telling them what is the added value for being a big shareholder. When they went cap in hand in a tour around Europe to increase their capital earlier this year, these were the type of reports that they were reporting to the bigger shareholders. So basically, how much your companies and your financial institutions are getting out of the IFC. And interestingly, I see Spain in both the companies and financial institutions. So they recently gave up a chair at the IMF, the Spanish said, but who wants a chair at the IMF when you are at the top three of both of these lists? I'm gonna rush through two important points and considerations which you can go more in depth. Well, we can go more in depth afterwards in the debate, but also in the report that you have on the back of the room. Clearly, all this type of business model bypasses country ownership. So basically, the IFC is very supply-driven. The investment officers seek for business opportunities. They have big amounts of capital and pressure to lend. And most of the times, they don't have enough applications from projects to really make a sensible selection for those who could have best developmental impacts. Also, they provide advisory services. And basically, they give finance to companies, but provide advisory services to governments. And one could think, again, that in the context of the need to have a strong role of government to be able to reap the benefits of the AI, that they could provide services. Like, for instance, the government of Bolivia right now is drafting an investment law, a new investment law. One could think, okay, how the government of Bolivia can draft this investment law so they reap the benefits of FDI via tax, via many other ways. But actually, this is not quite the type of advisory services that the IFC gives to governments, but rather mostly focus on investment climate, enabling business environment, which most of the time it's about the liberalization, privatization that Anders also was talking about. There are also serious conflicts of interest here, because you're lending or you're investing in companies, so you're actually de facto an investor, but you're giving advice to a government. So obviously, as an investor, you would give and advice to the government, which favors you the most as an investor. So there are serious conflicts of interest there as well. On the other front, the development outcomes. The IFC was also under big pressure to provide evidence that they contribute to development outcomes. And they developed the development outcomes tracking system, which it's a big composite of different indicators. The problem is that they mostly monitor, they say at least they monitor the impacts, but one thing is monitoring the impacts, the other thing is using developmental, positive developmental outcomes as a criteria for selecting projects. That's very different, and this is the state of play so far. They don't have poverty and social impact assessments of the projects either, and the scores of these developmental outcomes, they are not disclosed at the project level, so basically there is no way for watchers such as us to see how a specific project, a specific financial intermediary, has contributed to these development outcomes. They don't disaggregate the data at all by income and social groups, so you don't know the impact that this has had on the poorest of the poor. So basically, after all these issues I've raised and many more, which you are very welcome to explore in the report, we can see that the IFC DNA is not one that will support a strong role of the public sector and the public interest in their approach to private sector development. Basically, they have a choice of borrowing money to the IBRD, the public sector lending arm of the World Bank, but they don't do. Intendedly, they raise money in the capital markets to preserve their private sector, genuine private sector DNA. They are also extremely upset at the European Investment Bank, because they say that the European Investment Bank subsidizes companies, and this distorts the market. So basically here, in all this approach or rhetoric on how we should approach the private sector, you see a strong DNA which is quite antithetic to the public interest somehow, or at least to the role of the public sector in taming the market to make sure that there's positive development impacts for the poor. So basically, the bottom line is that in good old times, when the NDBs were lending to the public sector, the public sector could then channel finance to national development banks, national promotion agencies, and they, I'm not saying that these are angel institutions, but at least they could be more aligned to investment priorities, investment laws in developing countries. But once they've been all privatized and liberalized, and the IFC does the business bypassing country systems, this creates serious problems on whether all this support to the private sector is really aligned to the strategic interest of the poorest countries. So, in a nutshell, probably we should go back to the good old times where the IFC or MDBs don't have a role in providing finance directly to the private sector, but there is a more balanced approach in using these type of institutions, such as promotion agencies, national development banks, which still, by the way, exist in our countries and have a very strong role in delivering the industrial policies, the agricultural policies that our governments prioritize. So probably that would be the ideal scenario. However, since this is probably not likely to happen anytime soon, among other reasons, because most of these institutions no longer exist after 30 years of unfettered privatization and liberalization pushed by the MDBs, there's a number of short-term, immediate safeguards that we need to put in place to make sure that these institutions at least do not harm and, if possible, contribute somehow positively to development. So here you have rebalancing the amount of finance channel through public and private sectors, ensure that positive development impacts are an overriding criteria informing all stages of the investment cycle at the IFC, greater support for domestic investment, small and medium enterprises in low-income countries, align investments to developing countries' priorities, needs, and definitely enhance transparency. So, MDBs and private sector, did they happily live together ever after? Well, we'll see, and probably most of you in the room have a role, as I was saying at the beginning, to make sure that the ending of the story is a bit happier than what it has been looking in the last decade. Thank you.